genel izleyici kitlesi için uygundur.
Saat Farkı'ndan merhabalar. Ben Feyza Gümüşdoğlu. Farklı ülkelerden konuklarla bölgesel ve küresel gelişmelere, meselelere dair farklı perspektiflere yer vermeye çalışıyoruz. Her hafta dünyayı EkoTürk ekranında buluşturmaya çalışıyoruz aslında bir yandan. Bu hafta Arjantin'e uzanacağız. Kısa bir süre önce bildiğiniz gibi Cumhurbaşkanlığı seçimleri yapıldı Arjantin'de. Ve seçimleri oldukça ilginç bir profil kazandı. Aşırı sağcı, libertaryen, popülist lider Javier Milei Cumhurbaşkanı oldu. 10 Aralık'ta da görevi resmen devralacak. Oldukça çekişmeli geçti aslında. İkinci turda kazandı Javier Milei seçimleri. Tabii Arjantin ekonomisi oldukça kötü bir durumda uzun zamandır. Malum enflasyon %140'ların üzerinde. Ve bu konuda da Javier Milei'nin yani yeni cumhurbaşkanının oldukça radikal önerileri var. İşte ABD dolarını peso yerine resmi para birimi yapmak, Merkez Bankası'nı kapatmak. Bunlardan sadece bazıları. Bu hafta biraz dolayısıyla bütün bu gelişmelerin yaşandığı ve tüm dünyanın aslında merakla izlediği, takip ettiği Arjantin'i seçimler ışığında, seçimlerin sonuçları ışığında Arjantin'i konuşacağız. Buenos Aires'e uzanıyoruz. Kıymetli bir meslektaşım var orada. Julieta Nassau bizlerle biraz ülkesinin durumunu anlatacak. Biraz bu noktaya da nasıl gelindiğini, bu seçim zaferinin arkasında ne gibi motivasyonların olduğunu da anlatacak. Hi Julieta, welcome to my show. It's great to see you here.
Hello, Feyza. How are you?
Thank you very much. I'm doing fine. What about you? I should ask you actually, how are you doing after this crazy elections, let's say. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, well, we are still trying to understand what's going on here. It was quite of a shocking outcome, mainly in August. I don't know how much you know about the voting process here in Argentina, but it's been pretty long. To give you a little bit of background, we started in August with we have national primaries here that they work more like a national poll, to say it in one way, because all of the presidential candidates go to that election, and then you have primaries to solve, but also you get to see who is first and who gets to go out second and stuff. And in that election in August, Javier Milei, this libertarian outsider, got out first in the election, even when the ruling party and the main opposition party had two candidates each. Well, Javier Milei alone got out first, and then the other parties. So that was quite a shock here in Argentina in August. And then is when we started thinking, okay, this guy might be the president of Argentina. Then we had in October, we had the general elections where the ruling party that had the Minister of Economy as the candidate, which might seem kind of crazy thinking that we have a 140% of inflation here, that the Minister of Economy of that inflation and this economy was the presidential candidate. Well, he actually was first in that election, and in second place that there was Javier Milei and the main opposition party. Then in January, February, we thought that the main opposition party was going to be the winner of this election. Well, finally, they were out of the competition. And then we had this election in November where finally we got to see Javier Milei as our next president.
Mm-hmm. So it was quite a shock, as you also said, it was the second round, and in the first round the picture was quite different actually. So what made the difference, do you think, between the first round and the second round? Why did, and the other candidate was the economy minister, as you also said. So probably it was all about economics, as far as I can imagine. So what made the difference between first and second round, basically?
Well, there was a key element, like 2 days, no, the day after the election, the general election, that it was an agreement between Mauricio Macri, that is our former president, that is one of the leaders of the main opposition party, that is center-right or right, it has both wings within the coalition, Mauricio Macri gave his support to Javier Milei. And that was one of the keys of Javier Milei's winning this November. Because mainly, Feiza, it was a vote against the peronism, that is the ruling party right now. So most of the 55% that Milei got, part of it was against Sergio Massa, that is the Minister of Economy, and not that much for Milei. And that's one of the main challenges for Milei in his government, because none of the votes respond to him. It mainly is against the ruling party, the Kirchnerismo.
Mm-hmm. So, Julieta, I mean, people, the majority of the people, obviously, and I'm not sure about the younger generation, Gen Z, maybe you can also talk about that as well, was that much fed up and that much frustrated with the establishment so that they picked a complete ouster, as you said, a complete stranger, let's say, and a very lunatic person, obviously. So that's how much they were fed up with the establishment, with the status quo?
Yeah, we can definitely say there was an anger vote in this election. That's without a doubt. And mainly it's because the economy and also against the establishment in general, the establishment in the politics. Because, you know, we have 10 years without growth in economy. That's a lot. We have 140% of inflation. And we have a lot of people that is out of the system, to say it in one way. I mean, people who doesn't have formal jobs, and that's a lot. For instance, we talk here about like the Uber vote, that vote goes to Milei, or the Uber Eats vote, that it's people that are not within the formal system, and that's why they want an outsider and not a politician from the establishment, and that is part of the long-time politics here in Argentina that led us here to this crisis and situation where we can't see a way out. So there was also a shocking interview of Javier Milei before the election that he said, okay, if everything needs to blow up in the air, well, let's blow it up, like the whole economy. Yeah. And it was like the journalist was like, are you talking seriously? But that was what his voters wanted. Like, okay, let's blow all the country up and start over. Hmm. And let's see where I will be in this new Argentina.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the thing is now what is going to happen and how many spaces, how many room is there for this big change he proposed.
Go ahead, please.
Sorry. In these first days and weeks after the election, we have seen that some of these ideas he said he would change the whole country, well, maybe he doesn't have that much of a room for that. First of all, because of disagreement with Mauricio Macri, as I told you, the former president, that he's more moderate in some way. But also because he doesn't have support in Congress.
Yeah, I'm gonna actually ask more about that, Julieta. As you said, he doesn't probably have enough support despite his clear victory in the second round. So probably he's not gonna be that strong. He will be still weak. He will be a weak president in the parliament probably. But let me ask first about his ideas, because we have been also in Turkey, like the whole world, talking about his crazy ideas, right? So blowing up the, closing down the central bank, as you also mentioned.
And blowing up, he said that too.
Blowing up, exactly. The central bank and
I
also...
I hope he wasn't serious about that, but...
Well, he seems serious, bad news for you, but so he this idea and also dollarization, the dollarization also another idea. So he has so many ideas we have been also discussing. Do you guys call it crazy there? How is the... Because the whole world, including Turkish media, have been calling his ideas crazy. How is the Argentinian press, like, for instance, your own newspaper, La Nación, as we see here on the background, how is the domestic debate there? What are people calling his radical ideas? Could you tell us could you give us a summary of the domestic debates there about his ideas? And as you also mentioned, maybe you can elaborate on how much power he will have in applying these solutions for him in reality.
Yeah, sure. Well, in the first place, he loved being the madman. He loved being like the guy who yells, and that's how he's popular now. He was like a popular figure in TV from the last 7 years, and he's been in politics for just 2 years. So he got here like being the madman. There's a book about him, a popular book here about him, that it's called The Madman, because that's how people called him even in school. And he's pretty proud of him, and his supporters call him the madman. Huh. So that's the image he likes about himself. And about his ideas, yeah, the first one and the most important one is the dollarization, as you mentioned. He still talked about that in the final debate, that it was a week before the runoff. He started like letting some ideas go within the first round and the runoff, but not the dollarization. He said, like, this idea I won't let go because it's the one that made him win in some way. But the thing is, Faiza, and you know, for a dollarization, you need dollars.
Yeah, you don't have enough reserves, I guess, because many economists say that. I mean, this is not feasible because Argentina doesn't have enough reserves. So what is his calculation then? I mean, how is he calculating to ditch peso?
Well, now in the latest days, what happened was he started shifting a little bit towards a strategy of first trying to gain dollars and then going to dollarization, because he realized, I mean, he's an economist. He knows, he knew he needed dollars for a dollarization, but he still like sold it as his main idea. But now he's going towards an idea of first going out and getting maybe another like pact with the IMF. Maybe mm-hmm. we already owe them like $44 billion. So now the main worry is, okay, are we going again to the IMF and ask for more money and for another loan when we already have this huge debt in dollars, which we don't have. We don't have those dollars. Yeah. So the idea now is like maybe he's not doing that in this first stage. He also talks about like he has reforms of first generation, second generation, and he says like, well, maybe in a second term, and he hasn't even started the first one. But apparently, what we get to see, we don't know yet, because he doesn't talk that much about the concrete ways he's going to achieve his ideas. We think that the dollarization and the shutdown of the central bank is not going to happen in this first stage of his government. Now he's also thinking about who to put in the central bank, and who he's going to put as the Minister of Economy was a huge scandal here, because there were a lot of names. And you know, Faiza, in this kind of economy, it's really hard to get someone who says, okay, I'm going to do something with this economy. And that's what happened with Sergio Massa. That's why Sergio Massa thought he could be a president here, because we had like a month where no one wanted to take charge of the Ministry of Economy here in Argentina. That was last year. Mm-hmm. So he said, okay, if I came in here as a hero and I want to take charge of this economy nobody wants to touch, maybe I can be a president. And he was pretty close. And now it was the same situation here. We had this huge coming in and out of names, because it's hard to take charge of this economy, and especially when someone wants to dollarize the economy, which is pretty hard. We are a very big country with 44 million people. Yeah. And we are looking to experiences like in El Salvador, like Panama, like Ecuador here in Latin America, who dollarized the economy, but they are smaller countries. Mm-hmm. And they were in different situations as well. So I think that the first objective in his government is going to be inflation. And then he's going to think about going towards a dollarization or not. maybe they are going to, you know, live together, the peso, that is our currency, and the dollar, but not like erase the peso, that it was his first idea.
I see. Julieta, by the way, I know it's really almost impossible to explain or to summarize this huge problem of inflation. Of course, you are the number one in the world. You are leading all of us. I mean, you have around, I think, 140 something inflation. How did you end up here? If you have a chance to summarize at least a little, and like, for instance, people are blaming whom or what, the wrong decisions, obviously, but what were those decisions? For instance, we in Turkey, we had a similar maybe debate. I will also ask your opinion on that, but interest rates, for instance, President Erdogan here believed that for a long time. You are also following that, I know. He pursued a policy based on cutting interest rates, keeping them low so that the inflation would go down, but it didn't work, so we are back to orthodox economic policies again. But in Argentina, how did it work, or how didn't it work? I really wonder what went wrong.
Well, that's the big question here in Argentina, and depends on who you ask. There are different questions, but all of the answers are here in Argentina. We don't look away for that answer. We can see, like, a lot of people can say that it was Peronism, that is like this ideology that is more leftist, that started with the president Juan Domingo Perón decades ago, and that it rested on a huge social spending. So you needed more money, you printed more pesos, and then we started with this idea of inflation that now is 140%. But also there's people looking to the coup d'etat we had. We had six coup d'etat during the 20th century, and the latest was brutal in the 70s. It started in 1976. So many people look at that as the moment we lost the track in the economy. And there's also something interesting that Javier Milei, as Donald Trump making America great again, he promised to make Argentina the richest country in the world again, which is pretty, I don't know, crazy, because we have never been the richest country in the world. So he pretends us to be something that we never were. But that's true that a century ago, we were one of the richest countries in the world. Mm-hmm. And then what happened is that we are still relying on the same things than a century ago. We are relying on our commodities, and we don't have huge industries that gives us money and dollars and reserves. We do have a lot of potential, especially in renewable energies, for instance, and we really trust that in the future we get to develop those industries and to get more money from and more investment for that. But I would say mainly economic decisions and a huge social spending, and also political instability. Because what we have is that we have a huge polarization here in Argentina. So when we change from one government to the others, it's like you start over.
Mm-hmm, I see.
And that is really hard for the trust, not only for people outside that maybe don't trust Argentina and are not investing in Argentina, but also in Argentinians ourselves. You know, here you need dollars, for instance, to buy a house. And that's, I'm 35 years old, and that's all I can remember. I can't remember people buying houses in pesos because it has never existed. We have in the 90s the convertibility. It was $1, 1 peso. And after that, you always needed dollars to buy houses. And that's why, because even Argentinians don't trust in our peso. And now that situation with this kind of inflation we have now, it's even worse. We are being asked to rent houses in dollars, which is crazy because our salaries are in pesos, for instance.
Right.
And even if you want to go on vacation here in Argentina, you need to pay in dollars because as you don't have predictability towards the prices, then everything is going to dollars. So imagine, who is going to invest in Argentina if we Argentinians don't trust in our currency?
Julieta, I also wonder, by the way, I mean, like as a normal citizen, not as a journalist, as an analyst, but as a citizen, are you able to save, for instance? And also, I really wonder, I'm also curious about the spending trends there, because I read a lot of articles comparing Turkey and Argentina, or let's say Buenos Aires to Istanbul, because here also a lot of people say that there is no crisis, economic crisis, because people are spending like crazy. How is it there? How would you, because high inflation and long-term inflation also changes people's behavior too. So people are more likely to spend more because they are not able to save any money. They're not able to buy any house, any car, etc. So how are the, from your own experience or your family's experience, how are the spending trends there and trust in the system in the future at least?
Exactly what happens here, at least in Buenos Aires, as you say, maybe not in all of Argentina, but yes, in Buenos Aires. There was an interesting article months ago in the New York Times that said, like, everybody is talking about the economic crisis in Argentina, but restaurants are packed.
Yeah, I read that article.
What's
yeah.
going on here?
Right.
So it was like, and everything, I mean, there's a lot of tourists here in Argentina, of course, because nowadays, the dollar is so high that it's very convenient for tourists to come now to Argentina. And it's beautiful too, so a lot of people decide to come. And everyone asks the same question. And now we have a lot of journalists, international journalists here because of the election, and everyone's asking, like, but restaurants are full. Like, the most expensive restaurants, you need, like, months to get and to get to book. Yeah. to go to one of those restaurants. And it's not only because of the foreigners, it's Argentinians that go to those expensive restaurants. And that's mainly because of what you're saying. I mean, most of us, I mean, there's people, a lot of people, we have 40% of poverty here in Argentina. So we are talking that 40% of the country that maybe some months don't have food in their houses, okay? But in the rest, on the 60 other percent, there's people who mainly can't think about saving. Because why are you saving if we don't have even me as a young person? I don't have the possibility of buying a house. So why would I save in some sense? So we go out and spend money and maybe have a nice trip, which is not easy now to go abroad because we can't get dollars. But so we go out and go to a nice restaurant and spend money in the everyday things because we don't have the expectation to save money to do something big with that money because we don't even get to buy dollars.
Yeah.
So if we save in pesos, it's going to be nothing next month. So you receive pesos and you spend those pesos.
Yeah. So you don't expect... What about after Milei? Is your fears are even now like worse or a little hope? How do you feel now after the elections? This is my last question then.
Well, I can tell you what is, I mean, thinking about myself and not about the country.
Yeah.
My main worry right now is that next year my leasing contract, my renting contract is over. And I don't know how I'm going to go and get another house because everything here is in dollars. My salary is in pesos. My partner's salary is in pesos. So we can't afford to sign a contract in dollars. And I think that with Milei, that's going to be even worse because he is in favor of using dollars as our currency. So in the short term, I'm very worried. In the long term, I hope there are good news.
Hopefully, Julieta. Wish you all the best. Thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you, Feyza.
It was good to see you here. Evet, saat farkında bu hafta Arjantin'i konuştuk. Seçimlerin yeni tamamlandığı, kısa bir süre önce Cumhurbaşkanlığı seçimlerinin yapıldığı ve oldukça radikal söylemleriyle, önerileriyle tanınan bir popülist liderin, aşırı sağcı bir liderin, Javier Milei'nin kazandığı seçimleri. Arjantin'i konuştuk. Oradan La Nación gazetesinden gazeteci arkadaşımız Julieta Nassau bizlerleydi. Ülkesindeki özellikle biraz ekonomik durumu tabii ki anlattı ve bunun biraz kökenlerine de inmeye çalıştık. Seçimler sonrası beklentilerini biraz daha aktardı bizlere. Önümüzdeki hafta yine farklı bir konuyla, farklı bir konukla karşınızda olmak dileğiyle. Hoşçakalın.